Today we want to continue. We want to talk about, in the book of Mark, we're going to be in Mark chapter 12 here, and we're going to talk about Jesus Christ. And we want to bring, I want to bring you back up to speed a little bit. If you're here on Wednesdays, Joe kind of started in on the authority of Jesus Christ as he saw in chapter 11 and verse 27. And we want to remember, we just got through, Joe talked last week, Pastor Joe talked about Palm Sunday, Jesus coming in, riding in as king. And then he had done some things. He cleared the temple. Remember, the people were in there and they were using the temple for something that it wasn't supposed to be used for. They were buying and selling and doing things. And Jesus cleared the temple. I mean, he just went in and wiped it out, turned tables over, chased them away. And we come then to chapter 11, verse 27, and the religious authorities there begin to say, they begin to ask, by what authority do you do this? Whose authority are you here on? What gives you the right to turn over these tables and to chase everybody out? This is our livelihood. See? And they wanted to know why Jesus was doing it. And so they begin to ask, who are you? You know? By what authority do you come and do this? Who is this guy? I mean, think about this. In all this time, we get to this part, we're almost to the Passion Week, and they're still asking the question, who is Jesus? See, the crowd doesn't really know. The crowd's enthralled with him because of the way he teaches. He teaches with power and with authority. And we'll see some of that today. But the religious rulers, I don't know if they knew or not, but what I do know is that they didn't want to follow him no matter what. Because he was cutting into who they were, cutting into their ability to make money, cutting into their ability to have power and authority themselves over the people. And so now we begin in chapter 11, verse 27, and all the way through chapter 12 and verse 40 that we're going to look at today, and they begin to challenge his authority. Boy, that's a touchy issue, isn't it? Authority. Think about that. I mean, I don't even want to say, I can tell in some of your eyes, I can see it, that just the word authority conjures up different things in your mind. Because it does in mine as well. We live in a culture today that doesn't like the word authority. All right? We just don't feel like anyone should have authority over us. We should be able to do what we want to do, and no one should be able to tell me any different. Francis Schaeffer called it personal peace and affluence. All right? Personal peace is, I'll do what I want, and I won't bother you. You can do what you want. Don't bother me. Personal peace. We all have our own space. But see, that's not the way it is. Not the way it is. God is in control. God is the ultimate authority over us all in either one of two ways, and that's what we want. That's what you'll see today. Either one way, either he is our Savior, we know Jesus Christ is our Savior, and he is our Lord, and he is our authority, or one day he will be your authority as judge, and he will judge you for the life you lived apart from Christ. Even think about this. Let's back it down just a little bit before we get into actually looking at some verses. Everyone has authority over them, right? I mean, stop and think. There's not a single person in this room that doesn't have some kind of authority over you or over me. All right? Get out on the street and drive 55 and a 35 and take that right past the policeman and see if he doesn't pull alongside and show a little authority there, right? Okay? Everybody has authority. Look at the children in here today. Mom and dad are their authority. All right? Everybody has authority. We don't like it. We don't like to admit it, but everybody does. Everybody does. But again, Jesus is the ultimate authority. Who is this Jesus, they're asking? Why is he in there doing what he's doing? Who gave him the right to do it? Is he not a carpenter's son? What is he doing in here, clearing the temple? All right? And I love it because Jesus asked them a question. They say, by what authority are you doing? He says, listen, I'll ask you a question. And if you answer that question, I'll tell you by what authority I'm doing. Now, this was an accepted practice. The Jewish religious leaders, they always bantered back and forth like that. But rarely did one ever ask a question without first answering the question that was given to them. So Jesus asked them the question, the ministry of John the Baptist, was that from God or not? Seems like a simple question, right? Was that a ministry that God was behind or wasn't it? That was the gist of what he said. Well, the religious rulers looked around and they knew if they said yes, guess what? Jesus would then ask him, why aren't you following him? Why didn't you do what he did? Why didn't you go and be baptized by John to show your commitment to God? And if they said no, all right, then they would look bad in the eyes of the people, because then they would lose authority, because then the people would know they don't know what they're talking about. All right, so they were stuck, and they didn't know what to do, so they did the only thing that they thought they could do at that time. They tried to remain neutral. So they looked at Jesus, and they said, I don't know. So Jesus looked at them and said, neither will I tell you by whose authority I'm doing this. Hence, we get to where we are today. Let's see if I can get this. It's not. Let's see here. Let's try something. I'll try that. Push that button. Hit that button. No, that ain't working either. Chuck, I'm afraid you're going to have to move it. All right, because I don't want it moving on its own, okay? All right. So we begin looking at chapter 12, verse 1, and it says this. It says, and he began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a pit for the winepress and built a tower and leased it to tenants and went into another country. When the season came, he sent a servant to the tenants to get from them some of the fruit of the vineyard. All right, which was a common practice. What he did was he set up the land. He had it set up for them, and says that he built a tower, put a fence around it, dug a pit for a winepress. He set it up for them so that they could grow their crops and do what they needed to do. And it was a common practice for the tenants then to give back to the owner anywhere from a quarter to a half of whatever they bring in. So what he was asking for by sending his men to get, you know, some of the fruit was common practice. It says in verse 3, and they took him, he sent some there, they took him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. Again, he sent to them another servant, and they struck him on the head and treated him shamefully. And he sent another, and him they killed. And so with many others, some they beat, some they killed. He had still one other, a beloved son. Finally, he sent him to them, saying, they will respect my son. But those tenants said to one another, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. And they took him, and they killed him, and they threw him out of the vineyard. Excuse me. Before we read the end of it, we get to the part where the landowner here, okay, sends out all his men to go pick up the payment, and they all either get beaten, killed, or whatever might come, but they were shamefully treated. They didn't respect him. And then he has one left. He has his son, and he says, surely they will respect my son. If I send my son to them, surely they'll give me the payment that's due, but they don't. They kill him too, because in their minds, they're thinking, if we kill the son, then there's no heir to the vineyard. And if there's no heir to the vineyard, when the owner dies, then we'll get it. That's what they were thinking, okay? Is that one day the land would become theirs. All right? And they were hoping that this would be the case that it is. And as it often is, sin often deceives us into thinking wrongly, doesn't it? Because the next question that is asked is they ask there is, in verse 9, what will the owner of the vineyard do? I mean, think about it. What do you think he's going to do? You think he's going to acquiesce? Do you think the owner of the vineyard goes, well, hey, that's the luck of the draw, man. I send as many as I could send. I have no more to send. And I guess one day it'll go to them. Right? Absolutely not. Look at what it says. It says, he will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyards to others. Have you not read this scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. And they were seeking to arrest him, but feared the people, for they perceived that he had told a parable against them. So they left him and went away. All right, Jesus speaks in parables because he wants to make it hard for them to understand, but they perceived enough to know that this parable was about them. Here Jesus predicts his own death. All right, he foretells it. He knew what was coming. So when we look at this, if we want to understand the parable, we look at it this way. The vineyard then is the nation Israel. Okay? The vineyard is the nation in Israel. The tenants are there. The religious rulers are there. God has sent his prophets and others to come to speak the word of preparation for when the time would come, when the Messiah would come, that God was coming back. And they treated the prophets shamefully, didn't they? They killed some. Others, I mean, we read in the book of Hebrews, others were sawed in half. I mean, there was all kinds of things going on. And finally, he sends his son, that's Jesus. Finally, they send his son, he sends his own son, the Messiah. He is there, he is preaching and teaching and working among them, and they still reject him, and one day they will kill him. They knew it was coming. They knew it was coming. Even though he was there, think about this. It says that he was the cornerstone. A cornerstone in a building is the most important stone of it, of all the building that's put down. Because when you put that cornerstone down, everything else is built off of that corner. To keep everything square and true so that you have a nice building, okay? You don't want me building a building. I tell you, I don't understand the cornerstone thing. I know it's important, but I don't know how to use it. I can tell you. I've tried to build things, and they look good, and then all of a sudden they just go, I mean, I don't know how to build. You don't want me to be the builder. But Jesus is the cornerstone. He's the one. He's the foundation. He's the one that sets things up and truths everything for all of us, for all of life. And he is there, and he's helping them, and they reject him. It says again, he says, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Think of it. They were not looking for one to come like Jesus. They were looking for somebody else, and here comes Jesus, and God lifts him up to the point of being the cornerstone, the foundation, the most important part of the spiritual building, if you will. 1 Peter talks about us being built into a spiritual edifice. And again, that cornerstone is Jesus. The foundation is Jesus. Without him, we go astray. So Jesus says to them, listen, you don't know by what authority I've come, but I can tell you this, you're rejecting that very authority. You're rejecting me, and I am the Messiah. And think, and listen, religious rulers knew. All right, we're far enough along in the life of Jesus. Again, we're almost to the Passion Week. This is not anything new to them. Think about this. Let me get back to where I need to be here. Think about this. When Jesus was born, all right? When Jesus was born, when the virgin birth was announced, the name that was given to him when it was prophesied was said Emmanuel, right? God with us. That's a statement of authority, isn't it? That there was one that was going to come into this world, and he was going to be God with us. Then you've got his kingdom. It says Mary is told that his kingdom, there will be no end. The shepherds were told, and unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. All these statements present authority. Those are authoritative statements. One was coming who was not going to have an end to his kingdom. One was coming who was going to be the Savior of the world. One who was going to come and speak with authority. Think of John the Baptist. Jesus asked him, was John the Baptist ministry from God or not? What did John the Baptist say? Do you remember? I mean, think about this. When he was preaching out in the wilderness and people were coming to him and he was baptizing, and man, everybody was amazed by what was going on. God was doing something, and they looked at John the Baptist, and they thought John the Baptist was the Christ. They thought he was the Messiah. If you have your Bibles, take your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 3, and verses 16 and 17, and look at what John the Baptist says. In fact, we'll begin in verse 15. It says there, while the people were filled with anticipation, and they all wondered whether perhaps John could be the Christ. I mean, John, couldn't you imagine? John hears them whispering back and forth together. Is he the Messiah? Is this the one? Is this what the prophets have spoken of? Is this finally the man, the Messiah that's going to come? Look what John the Baptist said. Verse 16. John answered them all. He said, I baptize you with water, but one more powerful than I am is coming. I am not worthy to untie the strap of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clean out his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his storehouse. But the chaff he will burn up with the inextinguishable fire. Authority. Authority. He says there's one coming who is even more powerful than I. One who's going to come and do more. Not only that, but he's going to separate the wheat from the chaff. The wheat he'll take home, the chaff he's going to burn. Judgment will fall on them. Authority. Look at the baptism of Jesus. All right? In Matthew chapter 3, verse 17, Jesus goes in to be baptized by John. And as he goes down in the water, when he comes up out of the water, what happens? A dove comes down from heaven, right? And not only that, but there's a voice from heaven. And what does it say? What does God say? That's God's voice. What does God say? This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Authority. God puts his stamp of authority on Jesus and what he was doing in the baptism of John. And if that's not enough, think about the transfiguration where we hear the voice again. God speaks and he says, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And then he adds, listen to him. Listen to him. Listen to what he has to say. Because he speaks as one with authority because he's come from me. He is the Messiah. He comes with authority and with power. You look at Jesus' own words. What does he say? He says this. When he speaks of his relationship with the Father, he always says, I and the Father are one. Right? I and the Father are one. And he says, no man can understand the Father except the Son, and no man can understand the Son except the Father, and to whom the Son reveals him. Authority. Jesus says, listen, if you want to know anything about me or about the Father, the only way you're going to know is if I reveal myself to you. Otherwise, you won't know. Jesus also said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Very exclusive statement, isn't it? Very exclusive. There aren't many roads to God. There's only one. That's through Christ. He is the authority. He's the way, the truth, and the life. Also, when Jesus would teach, he would teach with authority, wouldn't he? Think about the Sermon on the Mount. What did he say? He says, you have heard it taught this way. Men have said this. But I say. But I say. And the people were just, they were amazed by what he had to say. They were taken up with what Jesus had to say. They knew that he was speaking the truth. They may not have understood who he was, but man, they knew there was something different about him. He spoke with authority. The prophets said, well, what did the prophets in the Old Testament say? They never said, I say this. They always said, thus saith the Lord, right? Yeah, see, Jesus came and he said, I don't need to say that. I am the one. I say this is right, and this is what you need to do. Authority. Authority. Look at Jesus' own action, his miracles. Jesus did miracles. They were good things to do. He helped people, but they were primarily done in order to reveal that he was the Messiah. That's the primary reason. All right? For all the good that he did, and I'm not downplaying that at all, but the primary reason was to attest that he was the Messiah. No other reason. No other reason. To establish his authority that he was indeed the Son of God. Think about the calling of the disciples. Jesus is walking along. He sees Matthew. He says, come, follow me. Matthew gets up and comes. He sees John. He says, John, come follow me. John gets up and follows him. I mean, all he had to do is speak, and they followed. There was no argument. There was no, hey, wait a minute, you know, who are you, and I don't know, and I've got a good job here, and are you going to pay me more? None of that went on. When Jesus said, come, they went, because he spoke with authority. But not only that, you say, okay, I'm not convinced yet. Well, let me give you one more. Jesus spoke and forgave people their sins. No one else could do that. No one else could do it. And just to prove that he had the power to do it, he would heal people. He healed a man there. He said, take up your mat, get out of here, and go walk. And the man got up and left. Jesus says, you wonder if I have the power to forgive sins? Watch. A man is healed. Of course he had the power. He was a man who had authority. But look also at the attitude of the people. I mean, they marveled at his teaching, right? I mean, they did. They loved his teaching. But not only that, remember when the soldiers were sent to go get him? I love this. I love this. This is great. They ought to make a movie out of this because it ought to be a part of a movie. Because in John chapter 7, the religious authorities send soldiers to go get him. And the soldiers go and they talk to him and they come back without him. All right? They go get him and the religious leaders go, okay, where's Jesus? And the soldiers say, listen, no one ever spoke like this man did. And we couldn't bring him back. Because he spoke with authority. They send him to go get him. They come back empty-handed. I love it. But not only that, when you look at Jesus when he did his miracles, he didn't get the same response that we see so many people get today, what you see on TV and other places. Because, yeah, they were amazed. But there were times when that amazement didn't lead to applause or fanfare or anything like that. He didn't get a write-up in the local paper or anything like that. There were many times when he did a miracle that it was accompanied by fear. It said the disciples were afraid. They saw what he did and they were afraid. Well, why? Why in the world would they be afraid if they saw a miracle? They were afraid because they sensed the power and presence of God in what Jesus was doing. And if we sensed the same thing, we would be afraid too. If God showed up in this place in as powerful a way as he did back then, we would be afraid. We'd be on our knees, hiding our faces, because we'd be afraid in the presence of God. We wouldn't be clapping. There wouldn't be this fanfare. So you can always tell when God comes down on a people, because all the normal stuff leaves. Okay? Martin Lloyd-Jones used to say he could tell when God showed up in the church service for him because his people always said amen to everything. And when they quit saying amen and they began to listen and they began to be moved by what was going on, the amens left. God was there. When God shows up, it's different than anything that we know of today. A lot of what we see is not right. But ultimately, we see the authority of Jesus in his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. When he rose again, he died in order that he might make the payment for our sins. He rose again to prove that what he had done was legitimate. He had power over death. Death couldn't even hold him. We're going to be celebrating that here in a few weeks. That's because he had authority over death. He had authority over everything because he is the Son of God. He alone. And you see, we make the same mistake that these religious leaders do and that even the people did. The people followed him many times for wrong reasons. They were looking for the benefits that Jesus could do. And if that's what we're doing the wrong thing. Jesus is in control. He is the authority over you and me as believers, and that's all we need. We need to come to that place where we can say that Jesus is enough. That Jesus is enough. That we don't need anything else, that whether in life or in death, Jesus is enough. In fact, if I can find the verse in here, y'all sang this, you're all guilty. Okay? You're all guilty. Let me see if I can find it here. We sang this. It says here, let's see, I can't find it. We sang the verse and it's not in here, no. It says, Here it is. It says, no guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. Y'all sang that. Do you really believe that? Is Jesus really enough? Are you looking for something else from Jesus? That's what the religious leaders were looking for. They were looking for something else. What authority do you have to come and do this? Who are you? And the people were looking for something else too. Maybe they were looking to get rich. Maybe they were looking to be healed. Maybe they were looking for you fill it in. Maybe they were just wanting to be happy and they thought, if I just get connected with him, I'll be happy. Well, guess what? Our happiness isn't his primary concern. Jesus is enough by himself. And if you're not happy with that, him being the authority in your life, him ruling your life, declaring what your destiny is, then you're missing the point. You're right here where these people are in what we're looking at today. And we're making the same mistake. Jesus is enough. We don't need anything else. We don't need anyone else. And if we miss it, who knows where we'll end up? See? Now, we can move on from here. We're going to look at the next slide because what happens from here on out is the religious rulers try to trap him. All right, that's how I know. They knew. Somehow they knew enough to know that they didn't want him around. So they're going to do their best because they wanted to arrest him anyway. So now they're going to try and trap him. So Chuck, if you'll flip to the next one. It says this, and they sent to him some of the Pharisees and some of the Herodians to trap him in his talk. And they came and they said to him, "Teacher, we know that you are true and do not care about anyone's opinion. For you are not swayed by appearances, but truly teach the way of God. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or should we not?" But knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, "Why put me to the test? Bring me a denarius, and let me look at it." And they brought one. And he said to them, "Whose likeness and inscription is this?" They said to him, "Caesar's." Jesus said to them, "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God." And they marveled at him. I mean, don't you love it? Here, the people that came, the Herodians and those that are there, the Pharisees, this is part of the Sanhedrin. It's not all the Sanhedrin, but they're sending some guys out, and they said, "Listen, go do your job. Trap him. Trap him in his own words. Because if he says the wrong thing, then we can arrest him, okay? And let's deal with taxes, because they didn't like paying this tax anyway, all right? They didn't like paying it. The Pharisees didn't like it. The Herodians did, and they always battled with themselves. Well, Jesus then, he comes up with the only answer that you could come up with. They hadn't even come up with this answer. And he says, "Listen, you look at that. You pay the render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, render unto God what is God's." And everybody was just, wow. Wow. How did he come up with that? Where did that come from? It's because he was a man under authority. He knew what he was doing. This is, follow me here, Jesus. All right? This is Jesus. He is the Son of God. I think he knew. Just a guess here, an educated guess, but I think he knew. He knew where they were coming. They were blowing smoke at him there in the beginning, you know, trying to butter him up. "Oh, Jesus, you're such a great teacher. We know that, man, you don't put, you know," and they went on and on, and Jesus knew. Jesus knew they were trying to trap him. But he saw through their trap. Saw through a trap. Chuck, hit the next one. They're not finished, though, okay? You would think they would learn, but no, they don't learn. Human beings, we tend to, it takes a while for us to learn things, right? It does. Let's be honest. That's right. Verse 18, and the Sadducees came to him, all right? You had the Herodians and the Pharisees there before. Now the Sadducees come, and they come to him, and they say, who say that there is no resurrection. The Sadducees don't believe that you rise from the dead. So they ask him a question, saying, "Teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife, but leaves no child, the man must take the widow and raise up offspring for his brother. There were seven brothers. The first took a wife, and when he died, he left no offspring. And the second took her and died, leaving no offspring. And the third likewise, and the seven left no offspring. Last of all, the woman also died. In the resurrection, when they rise again, whose wife will she be? For the seven had her as wife." Right? So, man, they think they got him, all right? We got a man that gets married, got seven brothers, six other brothers besides him. He gets married, he has a wife, he dies, doesn't have any offspring, and it goes on down the line. And so, who does she belong to? All right? They don't learn, okay? That's all I'm going to tell you. They don't learn. Jesus said to them, "Is this not the reason you are wrong? Because you know neither the scriptures nor the power of God." Ouch. All right, let's just say, ouch. These were the Sadducees. These were religious leaders. They were teachers of the law. Jesus says, "Listen, the reason why you're wrong is because you don't know the scriptures." Ouch. All right. "For when they rise from the dead, they are neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven." All right. He says, if you understood the scriptures, you'd understand that when they get to heaven, there is no marriage in heaven. Now, don't ask me what else about that. Ask Pastor Joe. I'm sure he's got all the answers to that part. I don't know what to tell you about that, okay? I know that's what it says. I don't understand it. I don't know what it means for me and my wife. My wife always asks me, are we still going to be married? If we're not going to be married in heaven, what are we going to be? I don't know, all right? I know God is good. I don't know. Pastor Joe, he's very relaxed today. This would be a good time to ask him this, okay? So I don't know. All I know is they didn't understand that that was the right answer to the question. Let's read on. It says, "And as for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the passage about the bush, how God spoke to him, saying, 'I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob.' He is not the God of the dead, but of living." Jesus says, "Therefore, you are quite wrong." All right? He not only gets them because they didn't know the scriptures about whose wife it would be and what it was like in heaven after you die. He gets them about the resurrection as well because he says, "Listen, you quote Moses, you don't understand. Moses' God was the God of the living and not the God of the dead." And again, the people went, "Wow, this man is something else." Think of that answer. He just told the Sadducees that they not only didn't know the scriptures, but they were quite wrong in what they had to say. This guy is good. All right? This guy is good. But again, it comes back to it's Jesus. It's Jesus. He knew the scriptures. He was sent from God. He's the Son of God. Why wouldn't he know these things? Why did they think they could trap him? Because they were angry. Because they wanted to get rid of him. Because they didn't believe what he had to say. Because if they believed what he had to say, then they would have to do what he had to say, which meant that they would have to give up the lifestyle they had. And those religious leaders didn't want to do it. They didn't want to do it. Listen. Whenever there is a change of power, whether it's in government or whether it's religious, it never goes easy. All right? It never goes easy. And many times, if you look in history, the exchange can often be quite bloody. Only in the United States, right now, do these exchanges go peacefully. And the reason they do is because of the influence of the gospel on our culture. And what those religious leaders were facing is that if Jesus was right, they would no longer be the leaders that they were. And it wasn't going down easy. Chuck? At this point, there's another scribe that comes up. He happens to be coming by while all this is going on, and he hears the debate. Okay? And he says this. He says, "One of the scribes came up and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that Jesus answered them well, asked him, 'Which commandment is the most important of all?' Jesus answered, 'The most important is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one.'" It's called the Shema. It's in Deuteronomy chapter 6. It's called the Shema because the word Shema means to hear. And so they would say this all the time. This was one of them. It says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength." Right there in Deuteronomy chapter 6. So Jesus gives them the greatest commandment. But he doesn't stop there. He says, "The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." And the man says, the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher." Duh. I mean, come on. You know? He hasn't missed one this whole time. Do they really think he's going to miss one now? He says, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one and there is no other besides him. And to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding, with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is much more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." And when Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." Notice the response. And after that, no one dared ask him any more questions. All right, they wanted to know. I mean, they were enjoying this. In fact, this guy was enjoying the answer that Jesus gave him, and he answers well. And Jesus says, "Listen, you're not far from my kingdom." Man, that shut everybody down. So they wouldn't be identified with his kingdom. They didn't know what to say. "You're not far from my kingdom." Whoa, I can't get that reputation. You know, I got to back up. But here Jesus responds in an authoritative way to all these things as they try to trap him in everything that they're trying to do. And they couldn't do it. They couldn't do it. And this is just one more example through Jesus' teaching of the authority that he has. See, you wonder why, I wonder why, that I don't at times listen to what Jesus has to say, don't you? I mean, if we know that he has the authority, if we know that he has the answers, we see it in the scriptures and the illustrations that were given and the life that he led. Why would we refuse to come under his authority and do what he says? And yet we do. But Jesus wasn't done. Jesus had him. Chuck, can you hit the next one? Here in verse 35, it says, and as Jesus taught in the temple, he said, how can the scribes say that the Christ is the son of David? Now, Jesus has a question for them. Okay? How can they say that Christ is the son of David? David himself in the Holy Spirit declared, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under my feet. David himself calls him Lord, so how is he his son? Question. If David says that Jesus is the Christ, how can he be David's son? There's one for the influence friends and family, right? Sit down with them, ask them this question. See who has the right answer. They didn't know what to say. And Jesus said this on purpose because he wanted to clear up any misconception that they may have had about who he was. I mean, think about it. He has just said that Messiah would be David's son, right? Isn't that what it says? You can say yes. It's not a trick question. I'm not trying to catch you here. It's true. He says, David himself. How is he his son? Wasn't the Messiah going to be the son of David? Yes. Yes. How could the son of David then be David's Lord? Whoa. Another one for Pastor Joe, right? How could he do it? What was going on here? What was being said? Right? They knew. They knew. The very fact that nobody spoke up and said anything lets us know that they understood what he was saying. They may not have had it all, but they understood where he was coming from and what he was getting at. He let them know, I am the Messiah. I am the Son of David. I am the one that the prophet spoke of. I am Jesus the Christ. I am all that you need. Why look anywhere else? And what does it say about the people? It says the people marveled. The great throng heard him gladly. Man, they heard that and they were excited. They knew something was going on. Here was a man declaring himself to be the Messiah, the Son of David. He was doing the works to back it up. He was giving them authoritative teaching. He was putting down the religious rulers of their day, which, by the way, Jesus goes on, he doesn't give a very good commentary about them either. Let's look for a minute. Verse 38 says, and in his teaching he said, beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and like greetings in the marketplaces and have the best seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at feasts, who devour widows' houses for a pretense, make long prayers, and they will receive the greater condemnation. That doesn't give them good press, does it? I mean, you know, he wasn't saying follow them. He says, beware of the false teachers because they are teaching with a false authority. I am the Messiah. Come under my authority and live. Come under my authority because my yoke is light and my yoke is easy, my burden is light. Come under my authority and know me and realize you don't need anything else. Because to know Jesus is to take us to a place where whether in good or in bad, we're with him. Right? I mean, think about this. Think about this, and we're going to come to an end here. Think about this. If every day is a gift of God, right? We'd all would agree with that, right? Everybody? I see some of you out there going, I don't know where you're going with this, so I'm not going to commit. Okay? It is. Every day is a gift of God. It's his gift to us. So that whatever comes in that day comes from him. Amen? Now, before you say amen, think about that. Amen? That means that whether it's good or whether it's bad, whether we're happy or whether we're sad, it doesn't make any difference. All of it comes from God. He is in control. He is in authority over us. He is the one who sets our destiny, as we sang about earlier. He is the one who rules over us, and He is enough. So let me ask you today, as the praise band comes on up, we're going to sing. I'm going to get out of their way here for a minute. But let me ask you a very simple question. Is Jesus enough for you? Is Jesus enough that you have committed your life to Him? That you have come before Him and said, listen, I know I'm a sinner and I need to be saved. And I know that You're the only one that can save me. Have you been willing to do that? Have you come under His authority at that level? Because if you haven't, that's what you need to do today. That's the way you start on this journey with Jesus. Is you begin by coming under His authority through a saving knowledge of Him. And if you need to know more, perhaps you don't understand that. We would love to talk to you and help you understand a little bit more. We'd love to pray with you so that you could come to know this Jesus that we know. We'd be glad to do that. Pastor Joe would love to do that. I would love to do that. Just grab somebody and tell them, listen, I want to know Jesus as my Savior. Secondly, I want to ask you who know Jesus Christ as your Savior, is He still enough for you? Or are you looking for something else? Are you adding anything to Him? Have we gone a little bit astray to where we think that maybe Jesus isn't enough? Maybe it's Jesus plus my happiness? Or Jesus plus whatever? We've got to be willing to come to that point where we say, Jesus is enough regardless. And then we can worship Him, truly worship Him, from a heart filled with love and joy. And I want us to stand. We're going to sing a song, and I want you to rejoice, and I want you to give God praise in this as we exalt the name of Jesus, okay? So let's all stand and sing.